These are seppa. These are washers that fit on either side of the tsuba on a Japanese sword, and that crenellated, that filed scalloped edge, is what you see, and it provides a really interesting visual frame, in a sense, to either side of the tsuba. They also have a practical function in that, as washers, they can be made fairly readily to take up any slack when a new sword mounting is being made up. In this film, I'm going to show you how I go about making these seppa. And in fact, the pair you see here are the ones you'll see me making throughout the film that follows. The copper I'm using is 1.2 millimeters thick, and it's in an as-rolled state, that is to say, it's not been annealed. Right, so the film that follows was actually done in a studio with the public wandering in and out. This is Isabella Day's studio. It's, she's doing the filming, because obviously I can't do this while I'm doing this work. So you'll occasionally hear members of the public nattering in the background. I hope it doesn't detract, rather that it adds a bit more to the reality of day-to-day work in a studio. So I scribed it on and quickly sawed it. Unfortunately, I sawed it too accurately, so I can't really illustrate the technique I wanted to. So I've had to do it again and saw away from the line. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to file that bevel as before, just a little sequence to show you as close as I can what's actually happening.
The first step now, then, after having sawn close to the line, is to take a fine cut file and at an angle, just a very gentle angle, just go along the edge, creating a tiny little bevel, just coming up to the line. Now you can use a fine file, you're not taking much metal away, it's a very light touch, just to the line. And now, having established that little bevel, I can use a coarser file. I'm holding the piece of metal, the copper, at 90 degrees to the face of the file. I can work fairly quickly, working up as I can see the bevel. I don't have to keep checking the scribe line. So I've got a good visual reference looking straight down on the metal, and I can move along very rapidly. Notice I'm doing one piece, getting it quite close to the line, if not almost on it, and then moving along. So it's a very careful, graduated progress. And to finish this sequence of filing, I'm using a fine cut file. I think this is a number 4. Just going over the surface again. Obviously, when using a coarser file, you'll get a big burr rolling over. So it's important to use a finer file to finish up.
Okay.
This is a number 4 cut, quite a fine hand file. You can see that silver and copper, this where the soft silver has got stuck in the teeth of the file, is called pinning. And of course, when you file, that's going to leave streaks and scratches in the metal. So first thing you can do is use a piece of hardwood. This is African blackwood. And working along the grain of the teeth of the file, you can rub it out. And that gets rid of most. And you can see it makes little teeth in the wood. And that helps clean the file. Those bits which are still stuck, you can go in with a pin in a pin vise and literally just pop them out. And this is worth doing periodically, especially in your finer files. As I said, these little bits are called pinning, and they do make your file work quite rough. So that's how you clean it, using a piece of hardwood. Right, so here's the file all nicely cleaned. I mentioned I used African blackwood. You can, of course, use any hardwood. What you want is a nice, dense hardwood that will conform to the gaps between the teeth and might form a little rake. That's what you're really looking for. And the reason we want to use something like that is that your usual file card or brush for cleaning bigger files simply is too big to get into these gaps. But as you can see, it's nicely cleaned now, and those little silver bits I picked out with a pin. It takes a little bit of time, but for the sake of 10 minutes working on your files once a week, it really will make a difference to your filing. So I'm supporting the seppa in my hand like this, and I'm resting the edge of the seppa up against the bench peg here. So all the pressure is going into the bench, and my finger is resting against the peg here, so it's nice and secure. Using that fine cut file, that number 4 that I just cleaned, I'm now going to file at a slight angle here, and I'm holding it in this position so I can see the line, the scribed over line. I sawed just off the line, obviously, previously. Now I'm going to file at a slight angle. I'm just paring away the metal. I'm using a fine file so I can just come up and just touch the scribe line. I'm going to go all the way around like that, and then I'll show you how I then move on to do the rest of the filing. So I come around, and I'm literally just paring it off. Notice I'm at an angle here, and this piece is being supported nicely. Bring it around. I'm trying to maintain the same angle as I go around, just touching the scribe line. So I'm watching the light play on that line as the file gets to it, and I only move forward once I've reached that line, so I don't have to go back. This is a one-pass operation. Now, because I'm coming at an angle, I'm only taking a little bit of metal off, so I can just gently stroke it. It's not a lot of work, but having done that now, I've established the oval. Of course, there's excess material here now, but I can now hold this against the bench peg, and I'm looking down on the bevel on this side. I can see that clearly, and now I can file with a coarse cut. This is a number 1, I think. And I can just file away, and I can see when it hits that bevel, I'm on the line, and I don't have to keep checking back and forth. I'm already there. I don't know why I'm going backwards. I normally go forward. There we go. You can see there, I've gone to the line. There's still a little bit of bevel there, so I'm moving forward now. So I'm watching that little bevel disappear, and as the file stroke just hits the last bit of it, and now I'm on the line. So that's the face as finished with the coarser file. If you were looking for real precision, so 1/10 of a millimeter precision, you'd want to go further, because this coarse finish will leave a slight burr that rolls over. So if I were to feel here, I'd feel that burr. That burr, of course, then impinges on that scribe line, so it's not absolutely accurate. So going back to that finer file, we're going to go back and just dress the face. And this allows me now to go really that last 1/10 of a millimeter and really get rid of that last bit of sort of residual bevel, really get a nice
accurate finish. Also, incidentally, it means when I come to emery or whatever finish, stone or whatever, that's a nice smooth finish. And you can see there's absolutely no bevel there. There's a hint of a bevel there. I could go back and just touch it. I'm being very, very pedantic now. Jewelry making, for the most part, doesn't really require a hundredth of a millimeter precision, but I always think if you can achieve it, you might as well. So, yeah, finish up with a fine file. You get rid of that coarser burr, and your accuracy is magnified. I can feel there's a slight burr here. If I'm going to measure off this line with scriber or anything, that burr may get in the way. So, using a fine file again, just the lightest of touch, literally just to kiss that edge to get rid of that burr. That's just a general practice whenever you're filing. Always get rid of that little burr. That means your next phase has a nice even edge to come off. Right, having filed up the edge, I've just prepped the upper surface with Scotchstone so that my next step where I start marking out is a little bit more visible. So what I want to do now is roll over this edge, a bit like that. So we've got a rolled over edge in preparation for notching it, like that, and then scalloping in between the notches. So in preparation for rolling off the edge, I'm going to use dividers and mark it along here. This is the Starrett divider. This is actually smaller than the 3-inch you can get. I have no idea where I got this one from. It's rarer than unicorn teeth. So now I'm going to put the first facet on this edge in preparation for rolling it over.
So when you saw me start filing this oval on the narrow ends, I was able to hold it and file from the outer edge towards the center of the copper. Obviously when I'm doing the sides, that's a little bit more difficult because my finger will be in the way, or my thumb will be in the way. So I've changed my grip and I'm filing from the inside out, as here.
That's the first step. Now I'm going to use a finer file just so it's a little easier to see, and I'm going to put little facets on the other two new corners now. So this one. So that's the upper bevel. And now I'll do the last one. Just rolling it over to the base of the seppa. This is where it would rest up against the suba, for example. So in case you're wondering why I'm putting facets on to the edge of a piece of metal that I want to round over, let me explain. If you've got a piece of metal like that and you want to ultimately roll it over like that, if you simply start filing, what happens is the file tends to concentrate on the high spot and you may end up with something like this. And then you buff it off. You haven't really taken away the bulk of the metal here and here, because the file will tend to take off the easiest parts. And that's the problem with this approach. So instead, this is the ideal shape we want. So you put a bevel on it and take that material away. And then I do another bevel, take that material away, and another bevel and take that material away. And in fact, with a very sharp curve, you could do many bevels. And then what you're left with is just small high spots. So that when you do come to roll your file over, and that's the next step I'll be doing now, rolling the file as you go, you then get a nice even transition. Those little high spots between the planes, and that's the shape you want, those little high spots will more readily come away because the file will catch them. And very quickly, you will adopt the shape that you actually want rather than just rounding a shape and it just happens to be round by accident. Now, obviously on an oval shape, that's nice and even, or a round shape, it's even. But if you've got a shape that's more complex, of course, these bevels really do help you control this kind of rounding that you're looking for. So now I'm going to roll over the edge, having put in the little planes, taken off the bulk of the metal, and we've got the rough shape underneath those bevels. This is now a filing technique to blend those planes together. So starting back here, you'll notice I'm doing this rolling motion. And I'm going to bring the file edge up to my scribe line on top. Bring it round. And then rolling it back. Just gently, but like when we did the safety edge chisel. Same technique. Roll up to the line. The light's playing on it, so I can really see my progression of file marks as they roll towards the line, and then I can roll back.
This is the action that's really quite important. You'll see how I'm both rolling the file, so I'm not trying to establish flat planes anymore. I'm trying to roll over the surface that I've created, and I, with that, I'm allowing the seppa, the copper, to roll also. So I'm allowing both to work together, trying to achieve that roundness.
Now I can come on this side.
And as before, I've had to adjust my grip, so I'm filing from the inside out now, rolling over.
And rolling over.
Rolling in. It's the same technique, just having to adjust one's grip accordingly.
Come up to the line ever so lightly, and then roll it back.
And once more in close-up and slow motion. Hopefully this will allow you to see how the file is gently stroking along in successively fine rolled strokes to create that final form.
This technique would apply to rings also, filing a flat strip into a half round or D-shape, D-section, wedding band or bangle for instance. It's the same procedure. Right, having achieved the rolled edge we require on the seppa over here, we're now going to proceed to cutting notches around the outside. I'm going to use dividers to evenly mark the gaps, and then I'm going to use a very fine saw blade in the piercing saw to cut those notches, and then using very fine needle files, proceed to scalloping the little spaces in between the notches. Right, so when I was preparing rolling off the edge, of course I scribed a little dividing line from the edge to here, and now I'm going to mark the little segments out for the notches. This is, of course, where the very small and delicate divider or compass comes in handy. So that's my gap there. I've marked two, and I put the point in that one. I can feel it. I can just make a little indent. The next one, I can feel it. Indent. Feel it. Indent. Feel it. Indent. And you go all the way around. So this is one of the reasons I really do favor a delicate little compass like this. I'm trying to do fine work so much easier with a small, fine precision instrument. They are expensive, but this one has paid for itself time and time again in my work. So here I'm cutting the notches, just lining the blade up on the center of the dot. This is a 3-0 blade. It's adequate for this particular scale I'm working at. If I wanted something really fine, I'd perhaps use a 6-0 or even an 8-0 for a very fine slot. So I'm lining up on the notch, and I go forward, and I've locked it, and now I can pull back. That's all I need to do. Notice I use my thumb to position and then put it down. Thumb to position. You can go forward and you've got a little notch and come down, but it's copper, so it should take quite nicely. Put it in position and one firm draw. So you find your own way of being accurate. Very important that the piece is secure on the bench peg, not really bouncing around. So you notice I'm holding it quite firmly. It's supported nicely on the peg. The peg's flat. So this is one of the few occasions where it's permitted to use the file in a vertical way as opposed to usual orthodox way. I'm filing the little notches between the, filing the little groove rather, between the notches we've sawn. And I really want the groove to touch the edge of the notch each time. And then just roll it forward so that the tip of the little groove just touches the top line there. Using my thumb again to control the position. Once I've got a little notch, I can then look at it and go, okay, is that center? If not, I can put a bit of pressure to either side to center it. Get a little notch. Concentrating on the front, so I've got a good little groove. Once I've got a good groove, I can gently ease the file back until it touches the high spot over there. This is a very fine and very delicate escarpment file, a watchmaker's file. I'm using. It's very thin, so it doesn't require a lot of pressure. More likely to break it if you press too hard. So I'm holding it at this angle so I can now really see the crenellations and the petals I've created. And using that fine file again, I can just come in here and just make sure these curves are nice and that they come right to the edge of the notches. So at this angle, I can really see and go back and forth and adjust them so that they all have a nice even shape as I'm coming along, because the notches are quite well defined. And then with the very fine file, I can just run over the edges like this to soften them, and I can see them a little bit more clearly. Hazards of filming in public. Welcome to Devon. And so just coming back and forth, and I can really see the shape, and I can just sculpt it very nicely. And as I said, taking the file, just gently running over the surface, softening the edges, and that way I can see each form quite nicely. You really don't want this to look like a mechanical thing. It really has to have a gentle, organic feel to it, albeit very regular. Nature can be very regular as well, obviously. Okay. Right, so this little area is done reasonably well. There's a little bit more fine refining I can do later, but what I'm going to do now is use the triangular file and scallop the underside of each of the petals. So to do that, I need to turn it over, and I'm going to be working. Those notches that we cut are still there, and I'm going to be filing back and rolling, so creating a little curve on the back of each petal. So what that will mean is on the edge, along here, we'll see those lips. So now using that little triangular, very fine escarpment file, I'm going into the little sword notches, catching it, and just going back and forth. Just a little start. That's all I need in the first instance. Just that. So now I'm just going back into that notch, and I'm leaning over to my right and just rolling it slightly. Next one, rolling it slightly. Next one, and rolling it slightly. So I'm just curving it. I could go all the way along. And then I'll come back and go the other way, right to the center. It's a bit like doing the edge of the front of a safety edge chisel. You get the feeling that everything's the same thing ultimately. And you can see now, by rolling from that side and that side, I've created a little curve here. Right, so this little area here, I've shaped the undersides. And you can see how these little scallop pieces are like little petals now. And obviously I can go back and refine the shape exactly, depending on exactly the effect I want. But that's essentially the technique. The rest is just refinement and tweaking things to suit the look that you're after. Mechanical perfection isn't necessary, but the regularity is what matters.
If you'd like to see more of these kind of films and to perhaps support me in continuing to make them, please consider joining my Patreon channel. This is a subscription channel where for £3.50 or $5 a month, you'll be helping me produce about an hour's worth of film footage of this kind of quality every month.